Hallelujah.
Thank you.
In the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Thank you.
I will bless the Lord.
Yes.
At all times.
Yes.
God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. In the midst of diagnosis, I will bless the Lord.
Yes.
At all times, God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. In the midst of closing out to 16, which wasn't so kind to some of us, I will bless the Lord at all times.
Yes.
God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul, my humble soul, my sanctified soul, my healing soul, makes her boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt God's name together. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to praise my way out of 2016. Hallelujah. I'm ready to give a good shout to the Lord to release all that has happened in 2016 and moving forward with the anointing in 2017. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My. Let me stay focused. Amen. God is truly present in this place, and I'm truly grateful.
Yes, yes.
Allow me to open with a quote that just blessed my soul on today during preparation. It's a quote by Deepak Chopra, and it says, "Anyone who plays upon our sense of lack, promising to fill the holes we cannot fill, or think we cannot fill, has power over us. Once we give away this power, winning it back is a serious challenge. At the very least, we feel completely tied to our egos and their insatiable neediness. These are all symptoms of mistaken identity." So for today, we are going to briefly walk through a couple of scriptures as we prepare to walk into 2017. Thinking about this paradigm shift, mind, body, and spirit, so we don't walk into 2017 with a mistaken identity. We're going to go into this paradigm shift with a moment of taking our power back. We're going to walk into 2017, leaving behind 2016 in a moment of soul care. So let's set this thing up. First scripture is Isaiah 43, 18 and 19. Familiar scripture. "Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." Our second scripture we'll focus on as a charge as we look at this and experience this paradigm shift. It's called a prayer for victory in the NRSV commentary. It is Psalm 20 in its entirety, and it begins with, "The Lord answer you in the day of troubles. The name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and give you support from Zion. May he remember all your offerings and regard with favor your burnt sacrifices. May he grant your heart's desire and fulfill all your plans. May we shout for joy over your victory, and in the name of our God set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord will help the Lord's anointed. The Lord will answer that us from God's holy heaven with mighty victories by God's right hand. Some take pride in chariots and some in horses, but our pride is in the name of the Lord our God. They who take pride in chariots and horses will collapse and fall, but we shall rise and stand upright. Give victory to the King, O Lord, and answer us when we call."
All right.
Pray with me as we focus on the theme, "When your test is your testimony."
Right.
When your test is your testimony. Most High God, we avail ourselves to you for a mighty move of God as we close out 2016 and enter 2017. We know that your word is true and your promises are true and sacred, God, so that you promise to be with us and never leave us nor forsake us. So you are here with us right now, and we are so grateful. And you will be with us as we journey out 2016 and journey into 2017, and we are so grateful. And right now, God, we just avail ourselves to your word, God, because Tawana's words don't really mean much. It's your words, God, that I am asking, that as you prepared me for the days leading up to this moment, that you would continue to speak through me and to me for your people, so that we all might be edified and you might be glorified.
Yeah.
So in other words, God, right now in this moment, have your way. Have your way, God. Have your way. And it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So all glory and honor to God, and I'm grateful for this opportunity. I was telling Dr. J, which I affectionately call her, Pastor Lee, excuse me. I was telling her earlier, I felt like Jeremiah, because during this journey of diagnosis, there is just always this word that's just welling up in me that I just want to preach and proclaim and just yell out about the goodness of God, even in the midst of this. And then I get a text from my dear friend. Are you in town? I am. You want to come preach? I think before I even read proof, I'm like, yes! I am there!
Yes.
And I'm grateful because only God can orchestrate and ordain this moment. Because you may not be aware, I am in the midst of active treatment for breast cancer. And when I have chemo every third week. So the first week when I get chemo, I'm laid out.
Yes.
It's a wrap. Ain't no preaching.
Yeah.
No, it's just not happening right now. The second week I'm on recovery, kind of rebounding. And the third week I'm like this.
Amen.
So it just so happens that the third week, hallelujah, is the day that I have been invited to preach, and I humbly accepted, and I'm so grateful that you just heard my cry again for this opportunity to preach and proclaim the goodness of the Lord. So it's no accident that we're focusing on this theme when your test is your testimony, because I'm in the midst of a test. I can't wait to get through the test to create or to realize my testimony. I need to realize it and see it right now, especially since we had a tough year this year. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know some people made it through victoriously and they had new jobs or new relationships or, you know, healing and maybe an abundance of just good stuff happening. But I don't know about you, but I've seen one too many live executions on social media about black and brown brothers and sisters. Flint still doesn't have clean water. Aleppo is happening across the globe. Renee Lee Mamara, you may not know, he's still sitting in jail after a mistake, and we just speak his name. My beloved Prince died.
Yes.
I know Reverend Dawn is just going through something right now. She had to support me when I was mourning Prince, and she just didn't understand. She's not a Prince fan. This year, there were some closed doors, there were some open doors, there were miracles, great and small, there was Standing Rock, there was the election and the election process. I received my diagnosis on Monday, November 7th, and that was the week of elections. I did not watch a television. I did not read. I didn't even want to know the outcome, hallelujah, because I needed to keep all of my energy into my healing process. But it was a very daunting election process. Yet we are here.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We have made it to December 31st. Help me give God praise. We are still here in the midst of it all. Now, please note that as we go into our first scripture to set this thing up, that the scripture opens with, do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. Please be very clear, beloved, that that does not mean that we totally forget what has occurred in 2016 or prior. We can't just forget it. There were some lessons learned. If
but fail, that means there was something for us to learn in 2016, good, bad, or indifferent, or even with what we're going through right now. So we're not to forget it per se, but God is reminding us, just, okay, I did this then, but you think I brought you through then. Imagine what I'm about to do. I am about to do a new thing. Do you perceive it? I'm about to do a new thing. Do you perceive it? So that means your faith, your third eye, your spirituality's got to kick in and see something beyond your situation or circumstance. So it says, now it springs forth. Do you perceive it? And when something springs forth, it doesn't just happen like a flash of lightning. It takes its time to grow, to nurture, to develop. So you got to be in there with your spiritual eye, looking at that thing happening while you're in the midst of the test. Because God said, make a way in the wilderness. Not so you get out of the wilderness, not before you enter the wilderness, but while you're in the wilderness, I will make a way. Then I will make rivers in the desert. When you're thirsty, I'll be there. When you're hungry, I'll be there. When you're sick, I'll be there. God is reminding us that I did it before, and I'll not only do it again, but I'll do something even greater.
Oh, yes.
But you gotta believe it. You gotta know it, you gotta see it, because God is doing it. It's not that God is sitting idly by watching us suffer.
Alright.
You gotta see it and see beyond your situation or circumstance. It's manifesting in your life right now in the midst of your test and your trial. As we think about our tests and our trials and how God will make a way in the wilderness or rivers in the desert, we want to begin to bring that into 2017. This paradigm shift. We can't wait for the battle to be over.
Yes.
We can shout
now.
Yes.
As we exit 2016 and move into this year of 2017, let us do so with this paradigm shift. But let me pause for a moment. I love milestones. Like, I love when people start working out on a Monday. It's the beginning of the week. It's a milestone for you, an opportunity, a new beginning. I know that there's no major difference between 2016 and 2017, 11:59 and 12 o'clock. But there's something about that milestone that kicks us into high gear, that gives us hope, that gives us strength to say, nah, things are going to change. I'm going to do better. I'm going to live better. I'm going to eat right. I'm going to stop cussing. These reminders, these anniversaries, like we go to church on Sunday and then we go to Bible study midweek because we need to be refueled after the crazy week we had, and then we do it all. I love milestones.
My Lord.
Love it. Some people knock it. Some people say, oh, it ain't no difference. Stop with all the New Year's resolutions. Do it. Do it. Just have fun with it. Whatever's going to encourage your soul, make it happen. But in the midst of all of that, I can't help but celebrate New Year's Eve, because I think back to my ancestors when they were sitting there at 11:59 looking at the clock, thinking that they were going to be free.
Yeah. Mm.
So I gotta hold on to that during these trying times. So therefore, the charge for this moment as we exit 2016 into 2017 is learning to see our test as a testimony, just like our ancestors did. Although they were free on paper, they were still going through some tests and some trials and had to make manifest this freedom that was put on paper. So we're not gonna sit idly by and wait for this challenge or this test to pass. We're gonna learn to see God in the midst of the struggle. In this intercessory royal psalm, according to commentary, Psalm 20 makes the case that in the day of trouble, God will answer. Now, the psalm makes reference to the king, and this is definitely another preaching moment, but I need to make mention that although the psalm is mentioning the king, this psalm is not exclusively for someone who is a king. This psalm is not exclusively for those who were responsible for the temple, who were responsible for making sure that sacrifices were offered properly, and they were responsible to not only lead God's people, but to have God's presence in their life and to love God's people. So we're not just talking about a king for the sake of being king in name only. And please note, the temple that this psalm is referring to is where the Lord dwells and from where the Lord sends help. So please understand that in this sanctuary, in this temple, this should be a refuge for us to seek help from our Lord God on high. This should be a place of healing. This should be a place of deliverance. It should be a place of transformation. It should be a place of community. It should be a place of love. It should be a place of forgiveness. Because when the Lord is in the holy temple at all, the earth, be reverent and keep silent. This psalm has two parts. 1-5 is a petition, and 6-9 is the assurance. Hear a prayer, provide assurance. It says nothing about getting through your test or trial first. Pray, assurance. Knowing that God is in the midst of your test and your trial turns your test into the testimony. In the midst of challenge, there is an assurance of victory. Let's go to the word of God. The first verse says, the Lord answer you in the day of trouble, exclamation point. The name of God of Jacob protect you. Jacob, remember, who was then Israel, who said, who was the one who struggled with God, I will not let you go until you bless me. Yeah. In the midst of struggle, he's right there, I will not let you go. That's the test. That becomes the testimony. I will not let you out of my sight, God. I will not let you go, even in the midst of my trial and my struggle and my situation. I will not let you go until you bless me. So it's no accident that this psalmist mentions the God of Jacob. Verse 2, may the Lord send help from the sanctuary and give you support from Zion, because the Lord resides in the sanctuary.
Yes.
May the Lord remember all your offerings and regard you with favor, your favor for your burnt sacrifices. May the Lord grant your heart's desires, your heart desires that want to conform to God's desires and fulfill all your plans. May we shout for joy over victory in the name of God and set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all our petitions. These first 5 verses focus on petition. But then verse 6 goes into this affirmation. Now I know the Lord will help the anointed. Now I'm not sure what happened between verse 5 and 6. I don't know if something miraculous happened to the psalmist or the redactor, but all I know is that for the purposes of this moment, 5 and 6 is connected, and we go from petitions to assurance, knowing that I know the Lord will help the anointed. I know that if I don't know, like if something happened, but I know that now we're moving from petition to assurance, knowing that my test is my testimony, and I don't have to wait for God to see me through, to see God working it out on my behalf. Now that I know that the Lord will help the anointed, the Lord will answer the anointed from holy heaven with mighty victories by the Lord's right hand. Verse 7 says, some take pride in chariots, some in horses, but our pride is in the name of our Lord, our God. Some take pride in material things. Some take pride in things that don't mean much. Some take pride in things that will fade away. Some take pride in the fact that, yes, okay, I was diagnosed and I'm going to put all my trust in the doctors. They will collapse and fall, but we shall rise and stand upright. In the moment of diagnosis, it was my faith that kept me strong. In the moment of diagnosis, it was my relationship with God that did not allow me to worry, did not allow me to fear. I didn't even ask why. I said, God, whatever you are doing in this season, don't do it without me. Upright, which is why we are here right now, in spite of what we've been through, in spite of what we're going through, in spite of what we may go through, we are here. We shall rise. We will continue to rise. We will continue to rise above the hate, rise above dehumanization, rise above suddenly manifest in your situation. I am about to do a new thing right now in the midst of your test. Now as it springs forth, do you receive it? I will make a way in the